All right, so welcome everybody to Gaslight. My name is Kevin and this is Tech Cafeteria, where we eat traditional cafeteria style food and learn about tech stuff. We're glad you're here, and today we've got Brad and David from Musicli talking about the platform they've built to connect local businesses with musicians and license their music, so it should be pretty cool. Quick heads up, next month we've got people coming from Kinetics Fest, which is a really cool thing that happens down in Oxford. They build these giant things and you get to play on them. So maybe they'll bring in some giant things that you can play with too. Stay tuned for that. And if you would, just leave your trays at your tables. Don't worry about bringing them anywhere. We'll come around and pick them up at the end of the show. So without further ado, Musicli.
All right, thanks everybody for having me. I like how this is very much like school, where nobody wants to sit in the front row, except for you. Good job. My name is Brad Schnitger. I am the founder of Musicli. Last year, I was awarded the $100,000 Hale Fellowship grant to create a project, some sort of project that would hopefully make Cincinnati a better place to live. Right off the bat, I just wanted to say, I'm not a web developer, not a tech guru. I am a musician. I play the drums, guitar, and so this project was really built with my musician hat firmly on. So just a little bit about myself. I started playing music when I was 9. The first band I was in was with my two older brothers. We were called Sounds Like Schnitt. Later when I went to college, I started playing with a band called Jake Speed and the Freddies. It's a folk, bluegrass, Americana band. And then currently I play in a band called the Sundresses. We are a loud rock and roll band. And I think we've probably set some kind of record for number of times being invited to South by Southwest with 7. I've won some local Cincinnati Music Awards for Best Album of the Year. This past year, we were nominated for Album of the Year again. And anyway, so another company I founded a while ago, it's called The All Night Party. A lot of the ideas behind Musicli were born there, and we did a lot of cool music-related projects. So before I start talking more about Musicli, I just want to play this video here that kind of explains really what Musicli is and why anyone should care. Here we go.
Music is essential to the marketing, advertising, and branding of your business. The right music can make a connection between you and your customer that can last a lifetime and help shape the identity of your brand. These days, markets are becoming as much hyper-local as they are global, and authentic connections matter more than ever. So why use soulless, inauthentic music that doesn't connect with your customers or have any measurable effect on your local community? You probably never thought about it, and even if you did, you wouldn't have been able to do much about it. Well, now you can. Introducing Musicli, an online library of music from the Greater Cincinnati area that can be licensed for various uses. Greater Cincinnati is as rich with musical talent as it is with brands and businesses. Musicli brings these worlds together and provides you with quality music from your own backyard. Now you can license music locally while supporting and leveraging local creativity to grow your business. Everyone wins. Musicli. Sounds like Cincinnati.
Right, so there you go. And of course the music in that video was from a local band. They're called the Turnbull ACs. That band doesn't exist anymore, but their music still does, and that's the case for a lot of bands on the local level. They'll appear for, 3, 4, 5 years, and then they'll go away, but there's all this great content that was produced, this really great music, and Musicli is built to sort of, give life to that content. So Musicli is a library of local music that's ready to be licensed. Anybody can search and find and license music directly from Cincinnati artists. And like that video pointed out, I think the biggest point about that video is really that nowadays, authenticity matters more than ever. So by using local music for your business, it really can connect you to your community and give you that authenticity. So Musicli is where Cincinnati's music and Cincinnati's business can come together and license music in creative ways. And there's been a sort of a shift in the mindset of musicians. If you think, you know, 10, 15 years ago, if a band had a song appear in a Coke commercial or a Nike commercial or something like that, you know, their fans might revolt against them and consider them selling out. But nowadays, that's completely opposite. It's totally flipped. Musicians are really in tune with the fact that that music licensing can really be a new revenue stream for them. So they're very open to the idea of music licensing. We did a survey last year, surveyed about 250 local musicians, and the majority of them said that yes, they do want to license their music. But of that majority, most of them have never really tried to, because the pathway to music licensing is kind of confusing and difficult, and there's no real trusted singular place for them to go to. So Musicli was built to provide that pathway for musicians. We also surveyed some area businesses and found that of those surveyed, yes, they would. They said that access to this local content was a barrier because nothing like Musicli had ever existed before. You couldn't get to this music because it just ended up in somebody's closet after they, you know, after the band broke up. It's just sitting there. They also said that they would prioritize using it if it was easy to access and easy to find and easy to license. So Musicli provides this access. And there's two primary opportunities that we're focused on with Musicli. One is creative distribution and partnerships. And the other, of course, is access to this authentic local talent for music composition work and for licensing. Now, when I'm talking about creative distribution and partnerships, I'm talking about stuff like putting music on a pizza, which is something that I did with my band back in 2009. If anybody remembers North Slice in Northside, it was a pizza window. You could, for a short period of time, go up to that window, order your pizza, and request music as an additional topping on the pizza. So like every month or so, we would rotate out different artists. The pizza guy would put the label on the box that has information about the band, a URL, and a download code, and take the pizza home, and you could download the music. And it must have been a good idea because a few years later, Taylor Swift and Papa John's did that same thing on the national level. So I'm a little bit ahead of the curve, I think. So we officially launched at midpoint last year. So since September, we have been fairly busy licensing local music and teaming up with local business partners. And I wanted to kind of walk through a couple of those. The first one I want to show you was for Cincy Tech. They are a local startup incubator for tech companies. You're probably familiar with them. They were looking for some edgy, upbeat, hard rock kind of song to go with this video that they play at the end of their big breakfast event, where they showcase all the stuff that they've done in the past year. So we found some music for them, and this was the end result. And the band is the Killtones. I don't know if I mentioned that, so. So right, so you get the idea. So that was a project that worked out really well, and they found the right music, and they found it locally because Musicli existed. Another project we did was for Curiosity Advertising. They had a client, their client was True Moo Milk, and they were building an online video game for kids. And the point of the game was to, you know, kind of educate about the nutritional values of milk and also about the 50 states. And so they were looking for some folk Americana music, which, you know, in Cincinnati there's tons of it. We've got bands like Magnolia Mountain, The Tillers, Young Heirlooms, Shining the Spoon, and they ended up picking a song by Jake Speed and the Freddies. So this is the game. You go on their website and you play it, and all the while this music's playing in the background. So So that one worked out well. The client was happy, the band got paid well, and it was all local stuff. There we go. Okay, so another example of something that's upcoming, sort of another creative distribution. Arnold's Bar last year released a vinyl record featuring local music from artists that typically play at their venue. This year they're doing it again. They're releasing another vinyl record featuring local music, and Musicli is going to be issuing them a license on the artist's behalf. So Arnold's was a little concerned that they didn't want any legal disputes arising out of the use of this music, so they contacted us. So this year Arnold's can be sure they're using music legally and cleanly. And then, so that brings me to custom music composition work, and was sort of my eureka moment a few years ago when, through my work at the All Night Party, I was hired to create a custom piece of music for a First Financial Bank commercial. And for that job, I was paid more money than I'd ever been paid in my whole life for a music project. So it was sort of the birth of this idea, like, wow, if a library could exist of all this local music, and I could do something that would enable these ideas, these opportunities to happen more frequently, that would be a great thing. And after I play this, I'm going to show you the video, the commercial, and after that, I'm going to have my partner Dave Davis come up here and talk about kind of how we plan to leverage these opportunities and a little bit about the new music business model that we're entering into.
So we just looped this spot twice, mainly because I wanted to kind of show you where these pieces fit in terms of the lyrics with the music. The parts of the spot, basically the music was written around the storyboards for the spot. We got the storyboards, so actually I think the music might have even been done before the spot was done. Now, if you're in advertising, you've probably experienced something that's very common. I used to work in a big recording studio, and at that place, we would get spots, and a video editor would come in, and they'd cut something to a famous song. And of course, the client had no budget to buy this song, but the client's now fallen in love with Born in the USA, some song that there is no chance that they're ever going to be able to put in their spot. And that's kind of how this job started. It started off with a song that they couldn't afford, and we said, well, what if we could give you something that was a little bit better? And then by the end, their editors were cutting to the right music as opposed to a sort of funky storyboard. The really cool part about this was there was a good reason for them to use local music that sort of transcended just the mundane economics of it. And what that was is the access to talent. In addition to Brad and his bandmate Jeremy, Lisa Walker from Wussie sings on the song. John Curley from Afghan Whigs played bass and produced it. So what ends up happening is we have a lot of great artists in town, not just in rock, but in all kinds of genres. Believe it or not, Mohenjo-Daro is one of the most well-known Indian percussion tabla bands. They're from here. So we have a concentration of great performances here. The other part of it is, though, is that this was a regional campaign. And it was particularly highlighting a move into the Cincinnati region. So by using local artists, the bank's able to connect with local fans. Bands have fans. So the reality is, I want to go back a little bit, and we realized a while ago when we started All Night Party that something like Musicli was inevitable, mainly due to the changes that were happening in the market. first thing that happened was the recorded music market collapsed completely in the first part of the century. And we have 100 years of these arcane norms and weird legal structures that evolved around physical media and one-to-many broadcasting. Well, that warped the market in these real weird ways. Maybe you've heard that the song Happy Birthday to You just was released from copyright. I mean, you've known this song your whole life. If you use it in the wrong context, you are going to get a bill from Columbia Records. What's up with that? Same thing as with streaming. If you're a broadcast radio station, you get better rates for streaming than Apple gets at Beats One. What's up with that? Well, they're a broadcaster and we are grandfathered in. At the same time this was going on, the ability to make music became more democratized, cheaper, everyone could do it. Apple's flagship workstation for music production, Logic, got streamlined and called GarageBand, shipped with every Mac, right? It was out there for everybody. Industry standard Pro Tools, same way, there's free and cheap version of it. So the small fortune it used to cost to make records, once worked as a filter and a homogenizer, so everything sort of sounded alike, that's not here anymore. Everything can sound different. People can make records the way they want to sound them. If you're familiar with the band called Sleigh Bells, their records couldn't have been put out 20 years ago. No record executive would have done it. Now, the good news in all this was, in addition to the negative, something really good happened. Gaming uses were already getting really big at the turn of the century, and they were just the tip of this emerging iceberg. YouTube, Facebook, Netflix. Every newspaper in the world is now behaving like a TV station. Every TV station is behaving like a blog. And all of these uses work better with music. So it created more needs for licensed music. And the net effect is that it shifted artists' attention away in the way Brad was talking about from albums to singles. And it brought us a new business model for music. Just like always, artists have to connect with fans to make anything work and earn a living, maybe a little closer than previously. But what's new is they have to provide them with a reason to buy. In the past, the only way you could get music was either turn on your radio and wait for your song or buy a physical piece of plastic. That's no more. They don't have to do that. So unless you do both of these things, you can't make any money. Now the good news is, in the music industry at least, people have used us to sell other things for a long time. This isn't new. There's jingles, there's product placement, stuff like that. But for artists, there is a problem, and this was kind of the genesis of Musicli for us. For artists, you have to start off, you need some places. If you want to sell your music on iTunes and Amazon and Google Play, you've got to go to some place like TuneCore or CD Baby or Mondo Tunes. And you have to, if you want to get things directly to your fans without middlemen, you have to use someone like Reverb Nation or Bandcamp or Topspin. And if you want a license, you're stuck with these weird things like Music X-Ray, and they all have different deals, and you don't know which one to go with. And that's kind of the problem, because to make a living in music today, you've got to use something like all of them. The worst part about it is that unlike labels, which used to share the risks with you, and would give you some money and had a little bit of an interest in your record doing well, now artists are making it themselves. So we have this new label-less landscape. And this made this made a big change. So I hate to pick on Taxi, but they're the most well-known person in the music company in the licensing space. And frankly, it's amazing to me they even still exist. I mean, you know, look, this is straight out of the 1990s, right, in terms of their website. It looks cheesy and scammy because it is cheesy and scammy. And their business model is they convince artists to pay them $100 to pitch their songs. They might pitch them, they might not. They're going to send you some offers and things in your email and your inbox. But at the end of the day, you're paying to play the game. And that's the real key. Not only do they not have skin in the game, in this new marketplace, what's happening is artists are having to invest in the platforms. It's completely upside down. We didn't like it. Brad and I thought this was a really terrible model. And fortunately, we were working on other things at the time. And the light bulb moment for us, for Brad and I, was when we were approached by Possible, an arts wave, to participate in this project called Radius. What they wanted to do was engage the creative community with artists, photographers, and things like that in a unique way. I'll let them explain it a little bit. But the problem was that they needed bands to drive this process. And he had lots of bands. And our company that Brad and I were in before Musicli, All Night Party, had a big catalog. But unfortunately, we didn't have anywhere near enough variety. We didn't have near the spread of genres. So we had to go out and do these things individually and work well. Here's kind of how it all happens.
We need to cut these things that aren't constitutionally mandated, that are kind of on the periphery, the fluffery, like NPR and National Endowment for the Arts, those type of things, those are obvious.
Arts support is on the decline. And new research has shown why. People have grown tired of hearing all the same messages. So we decided to create something people would actually like to hear about. An exciting new film called Radius, about a mysterious superhero doing mighty things in the community. We promoted this coming attraction through a distributed social media network of arts organizations, artists, and local businesses. Our network encouraged audiences at festivals, theater openings, and other events to find themselves in our film by playing a simple scavenger game on their smartphones, capturing and uploading images of people, places, and things in and around those events. Hundreds played, generating thousands of pieces of content, which we then used to produce the very film we had been promoting all along. Photos of local businesses and venues became a Gotham for our superhero story. Portraits of the audience itself became the characters in our film, including our protagonist. We even gave people the opportunity to remix songs from music festival bands to help create our film score. Then, we combined it all into a unique, visually engaging take on the standard comic book format. When the audience returns to watch this film short, they'll find the content they had captured incorporated into every aspect of the story. But they'll also find the true identity of the film's superhero. It's them. Because they had supported the arts, they had triggered a ripple effect of benefits throughout the community. Benefits they had unknowingly captured with their photos.
All right, so what happened with all this was, what the story we're not being told in this is that the engagement was driven by the artists. They got the majority of their photographs during the Midpoint Music Festival. If you have attended Midpoint, you know that it's a very local-centric festival. It's one of the only music festivals that I've ever been to where local bands sometimes draw audiences for the headliners, for the out-of-town bands. So we used Radius as a means of hooking up different bands. We got eight bands. And in addition to giving us songs, we had them give us tracks for the songs, which we also shared out and let people remix them. The song that we heard in the background of this was Lions Rampant. They're actually a garage band, not a techno band. But the version that was remixed was by a popular remixer. So, you know, this is the sort of engagement that music brings to people. Music allowed Artswave to move a lot closer and make more personal connections with the community through these artists who are actively participating, not just showing up and handing out free CDs or songs or something. So that was kind of, for us, the genesis of this. How do we get, if we need eight bands, actually the same year there was another program that didn't use artists as well, and it had like 25 bands who got no exposure. And they didn't get paid. So, you know, this was kind of the environment that Musicli was born into. And what we've realized since then is that this new music model, no longer just applies to music, right? It's actually the new media model. Whether you're selling any product on a digital media today, whether it's pictures or words or songs or whatever else, you still have to connect with fans and you still have to give people a reason to buy, okay? And that's what music does for us. So, Musicli kind of put these things all together. Also at midpoint this year, to kind of bring it all back home, at our launch, another company from Chicago called Freeosk came to town. What they do is they give stuff away. And you would think if you've got a machine like handing out Tide, well, you'd have no trouble getting people to come up to get that, right? Well, you would think at a music festival, you have no trouble getting people to come up to get candy or pretzels. Well, guess what? People get free stuff all the time and maybe they don't want to take it. But if you put their favorite band on the machine and you give them the opportunity to get music, not only will they go to that machine, they'll go to it more than once. Not only will they get the free sample and eat the nice cookies or candy or whatever it is they're giving them, they will also click through and download the song. This activation outperformed higher profile, big budget music giveaways that I've been involved in, you know, since the turn of the century. Typically, these kinds of giveaways, if you think about Starbucks, they're under 3% for those cards, for those songs that they give you. They're doing really good if they see 3%. For us, when you match the bands to the people, if you're doing less than 10%, something's wrong. So that's a big gain, and that's a big difference. And it was by connecting them with a band like Pop Goes the Evil or Culture Queer, who a company in Chicago might never have heard of, whereas we knew, like, well, these guys work with, these guys have a lot of friends, and these guys have been around for a long time, and they've played midpoint a lot of times, and it's kind of their showcase show of the year. So these are natural connections that people can make. For us, growth is going to come when we find the Dave and Brad in another city. We can't tell people in Chicago who the great bands are there. We're not from there. So it has to be local and it has to be authentic. I am a tech guy, like Brad, reluctant, even though I'm a mastering engineer the rest of the time. So I actually want to look at Musicli. Give it back to Brad and he can show you what we actually do.
All right, so here's the platform itself, and I just wanted to kind of quickly show you how a basic music search works on here. If I can find the cursor, there it is. All right, so you'll notice that, of course, search is right up front because that's the primary mission of Musicli. We want people to go to musicli.org and start searching for music. We don't currently have anything tagged under meatloaf today, but I wish there was, so I'll just do a search instead for pizza. Because pizza's good. And we'll see what pops up here. Did I hit enter? There we go. All right, so here's a song, comes up, and if you look, this flips open, you can look inside it, and this is, here over here are all the tags that the artists themselves tagged up with. Usually, when someone ingests a song, it's their job to tag it. I'll usually go in behind them and tag it with some other things that I think are relevant. So if you kept playing that, you know, it's got the lyrics here too, and obviously pizza's in there. So if you were selling pizza or something, this might be a good song for your commercial. The next thing here is, so if you wanted to license this song, you just click license, and that brings you to the music license request form. And you fill this out, and it puts the song right in here, The Greatest Love Story Ever Told, because the guy likes pizza a lot, loves it, in fact. Let's pretend that we're actually making a broadcast advertisement for television here, and we're going to use it. It's going to be for a 30-second spot. The campaign's going to run for less than 90 days, and it's just going to be here in Cincinnati. It's a small pizza shop. And you see the price gets spit out right there at the bottom. The important thing to note about that is that the artists themselves get to control that pricing. Not me, not Dave. We suggest a base rate for all those different types of uses, but the artists can go into their account and set it however they want. and then you fill this out. If $800 is too much for you, you can make an offer, submit the request, we'll get that in an email, and then we can reach out to the artist and say, hey, somebody at Gaslight wants to license your song, but they're not going to pay $800, they'll pay you $600 for it. And the artist will probably say, yes, sure. So that's basically how it works. I wanted to now open up the floor to any questions you might have about the platform, if there are any. Yes?
So it sounds like licensing, that there's some legal aspects to it.
Oh, yeah.
You guys have like a lawyer involved?
Yeah, so all of the, absolutely, yes, there's quite a bit of legal stuff involved. I mean, any piece of music is somebody's intellectual property, so right. When an artist signs up, there are terms of service that you have to agree to, both on the artist side and on the searcher side. If you actually want to license a song, you have to agree to our terms of service, and those were all done by a lawyer. Yeah, absolutely. Anyone else?
Yeah. Are people actually copywriting the music?
I'm sorry?
Are the bands actually copywriting these songs, or are they just...
That's actually a really good question, because I wasn't going to bring it up, but there's some other services we offer within it. If you haven't copyrighted your song, we'll do it for you, or we'll help you get it done, because that's another thing that's really complicated. But it's not technically necessary in order to license the song. But it's for musicians, it's, you know, obviously you want to protect your intellectual property, so it's a good idea to do so. So we have another service that I can go meet with the artists themselves and sit down and walk them through that process. I've done it a couple times now since we launched, and so yeah. Anyone else? Yes?
How much does it cost an artist to get in with you guys?
It costs nothing. It's a free service. The deal is Musicli will take 20% of any license fee that we collect. 80% goes to the artist. And that goes back to the fact that I'm a musician, so I've built this very much with the artist in mind. So yes, we take 20% and that's it.
Industry-wide, that's a really good percentage.
True, yeah. Typically, like most...
Probably the best in the industry. I don't want to say for sure because I don't know everyone, but it's best I know.
Yeah. Usually it's like a 50-50 split. And typically, you know, another service like Musicli would also dip into your publishing royalties too. We stay clear out of publishing royalties. We just, you know, it's like 20% fee. That's it, and we're done. So, anything else?
So after a person who's looking for music submits that request, does the turnaround and finishing the actual deal happen all on the platform? Do they have to? Is there any sort of legal contracts that have to get signed outside of it? How is that actually complete, and they actually get a license to play that and use that music?
Right now, pretty much everything is approved uses only, so but we're working towards that point. Dave, you might actually speak to this a little bit more.
Sure.
So, yeah, that's actually a pretty cool thing. We actually had at the turn of the year quick licensability, where you could literally do the whole transaction online. And so the problem with it is that the size of our library right now is about 400 songs of ours. There's another 400 songs in some catalog partners, and there's another maybe 1,000 waiting from a couple other catalogs to come in. But at the moment, since there's 400 ingested, I do this, by the way, every day. I spill water. But anyway, at the moment, what's happening is, in terms of those things, when we did it and we didn't have, it would shorten the list of things that you could search for. So it was killing search, basically. The majority of artists, when they first get into licensing, start off with this idea of, I'm going to cherry pick every single pick. And it takes about 3 months to a year before you realize that nobody is actually going to put up with your ridiculous terms. So you have to suffer through a little bit of disappointment for a while, and then you say after that, well, I'll take whatever offers are out there. So initially we've turned that off and made them all licensable. So now everything is available and visible, approved and unapproved. So that means there's a lot of things. There are a number of songs that you could click on. I'd say about half of them. In fact, like all of Brad's library, are always available. So if you clicked on it and gave the offer that came up suggested, you would get that deal closed in less than 24 hours. And once we have enough artists that will allow us to place things, in other words, if we have 1,000 tracks that you can click by, then we're going to turn that feature back on again. So that's been kind of the fun part also is tuning search. We also, right now, you'll notice we don't have our facets turned on for faceted search. And that's also a function of we're tuning the search engine based on what people are actually searching for. So we want to get it really good at single word searches. And it's getting there. I'll give you one of the things I was kind of playing around with before today was I was just searching on colors, right? And I was really surprised that, like, you know, pink, 3 songs, what the heck? They actually kind of made sense. So, any other questions or, yeah?
So do you handle, the inventory aspect? So if I license something exclusively for 90 days, mm-hmm. do you make sure that that song is out of the catalog when other people
great,
are browsing?
Great question.
And then a correlation to that is, can I see who has used this song recently, so that I don't end up putting something out on the air a month after the rights expired from somebody else's commercial, and then all of a sudden it's like, oh hey, I heard that song in that commercial by that other bank last week.
Yep.
So
the first part of the answer is that we ask our artists for no exclusivity, because a lot of the best artists in town might have their music in 4 or 5 different catalogs. Which makes that difficult. However, that, first of all, it's like your need is noted, and we've thought about that, and one of the things that we can do in terms of, can you see where the song's been placed? No. Simple, easy answer on that. But maybe that's something we should do. I think that's actually, you know, having done music supervision for a number of years, that's definitely something that enters into my head when I'm doing a search. It's like, where's this song at? But one of the best reasons to use our music is that it's much less likely to be encountered. And once you go out of market, then it gets actually pretty safe. The second part of the answer to this, though, and to the actionable part, by making everything offer-based rather than click license, we can do that due diligence for you. In other words, if you find a song that you want to use exclusively, the pricing model right now isn't built to cover exclusivity, but the platform is built to add that as an upsell that artists can offer. So at some point in the next year, what's going to happen is artists will be able to designate a song as being able to be exclusive, and that means it takes the onus off of us to have to, you know, chase down 4 different catalogs and say, hey, don't do this, and it puts it back on the artist. Now, the downside to that and the block of launching it is that Brad and I have to have some assurance that the artist actually has their act together enough not to sell it 15 times to your competitors.
Right.
And, you know, right now, until Musicli can do that and offer that to you, we wouldn't represent something as exclusive. And again, what that means is if you find a song that you think you want to use exclusively, you'll fill out the offer form and say, I want exclusivity. We will pass that offer along to the artists and give you a price for what that costs. So the end answer, the long answer is yes. I'm known for that, by the way. Any other questions? Or? Cool.
All right.
Well, thanks for, meatloaf time for us.
I have one more question for you. Kind of going back at the same thing. So you've talked about different catalogs where I could place my song. I'm assuming a lot of these are the same kind of company as yours, were relatively small.
Yeah.
Have you thought about getting interconnected?
Actually, in terms of, I think we are. And I think, you know, one of the biggest new feature on my list for the next year is catalog accounts. And so what that means is if you get a catalog account, you can ingest all of your stuff to Musicli, put it on there, and you can
market through music. Like, I know your stuff will turn up in searches, and that'll all be great. The block for having catalog accounts is that we need to also have a catalog store, so that your customers that are coming directly to you, if you're paying us a monthly fee for that store, which is different than the artist deal, then you should be able, your customers should be able to buy that without that load, without that 20% load, and without exposing your customers to music from five other catalogs. So Musicli has to be able to do that before, you know, that's the path to integrating those things, so that Musicli becomes the place where you go to do the Uber search. But for me, like, you know, I'm responsible for all my parties catalog. You know, we used to use another catalog company. We're moving everything Musicli now. And the block for us is exactly that. It's that someone's searching all my parties catalog. I don't want them searching Musicli's catalog. I don't want them searching Fundamentals or, you know, some of our other partners. I want them looking at my library because they're my customer.
Anybody else? All right.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks for having us. Guess we'll get some meatloaf now.